Plan of presentation. Will be discussed the precise prediction of low energy QCD now and in near future. Then PI-PI scattering length allows to check these precise predictions. Also, will be discussed the possibility to check precise prediction using K-PI atoms. The long-lived PI-PI atoms, their observation, open the possibility to measure the length shift of this atom. And maybe it's a way to check these theoretical predictions with very high precision. And very short about process of Dirac, which is working on PSCERN at proton beam 24 GV over C, if this same setup without upgrade will be postponed on the SPSCERN on the proton beam with momentum 450 GV. It's the collaboration, and from Prague there are three groups, and I would like to stress that Prague groups are covered all type of our scientific activity, detectors, online program, theoretical investigation, data process and analysis, and run support. What is the place of this experiment in QCD? The QCD Lagrangian used as new symmetry, new at that time, of course, is chiral symmetry. And this Lagrangian, describing quarks and gluons, has chiral symmetry part and part which is breaking chiral symmetry. And theory allows to obtain precise results, precise predictions, in two extreme regions. In the region of large transfers and in the region of small transfers. In large transfers, input to the physical distribution of at large transfers gives only chiral symmetry part of this Lagrangian. At small q, we have input from chiral symmetry part, from part breaking chiral symmetry, and also these low energy parameters are sensitive to the structure of QCD vacuum. The precision of prediction is better if Q is less. For this reason, pi and pi and pi and k and scattering lengths, which are describing the process on the threshold, are the most precise parameters which can be calculated using theory. The main tool of theory is chiral perturbation theory created by Weinberg, Gasser, and Leutwiller. Using this theory, in 2001, Colangelo, Gasser, and Leutwiller calculated S-wave pi and pi scattering lengths, A0 and A2, its isotope spin in pi-pi system 0 and 2, with precision of around 2% and difference with precision around 1.5%, with precision of 1.5%. Why this precise value are, what is the reason that this uncertainty is 2.3 and 1.5%? Because in calculation, they used two constants, L3 is the main constant, and L4. And the uncertainty in L3 created this uncertainty in these physical parameters. For this reason, improvement of L3 precision will improve the precision of physical parameters. On this picture, we can see the dependence of low energy pi and pi and scattering lengths and their combinations as a function of L3. And L3 around unity, and error of this constant gives the error in physical parameters. In 2006, Mill collaboration first time calculated these two parameters using lattice calculation. Now, the number of collaborations is 10, it's 10 international collaborations, and they are planning to improve the uncertainty of this constant on the order. In this case, if we want to check the predictions of this constant, we must measure the pine-pine scattering lengths with precision on the order better than we can measure these parameters now. What is the way to measure these parameters using pi-pi atom? Pi-pi atom disappear or annihilate in pi-0, pi-0. And probability of this process is practically probability of decay on 2 pi-0. And for this probability, Kaif perturbation theory gave a ratio between lifetime, this width, and with precision of 1.2%. And if we measure this probability or the lifetime, then we can obtain the difference between pi and pi scattering lengths. 4% in lifetime gives 2% in scattering lengths. The same we have for pi k atom. It is the channel of annihilation. Kaif perturbation theory gives ratio with slightly worse accuracy, 2%. And if the lifetime will be measured with precision, for example, 20%, then for S-wave pi and k scattering with 1/2 and 3/2, we will obtain precision 10%. What is the way to measure the lifetime? Because as we saw, it's 10 minus 15 seconds. Straight method is impossible, but there is a other method. First, look on the pi plus pi minus production or other opposite charge particle production without taking into account Coulomb interaction in final state. We have this strong part and then you have free particles. If we switch on Coulomb interaction in final state, because we have two charged particles, then we have two effects. Excuse me for a mistake, it's not PP, it's pi pi, it's pi k. Excuse me, it's pi pi, it's pi k. Then we have two effects. For free particles, will be strong enhancement in the cross section as a function of relative momentum in their center of mass. If the relative momentum in the center of mass will be decreased, then enhancement of these pairs will be strongly increased. And we have the second new channel. It's production of these particles, pi pi, pi k, in bound state. Because strong part of two channels are the same, and Coulomb interaction in final state can be taken into account with high precision, then there is precise ratio, precision is 1%, between number of pairs with small relative momentum and full number of produced atoms. Studying these pairs, in our notation it's Coulomb pairs, because Coulomb interaction gives strong effect, is dominating effect. Studying the number of these pairs produced on the target, we know how much atoms produced on the same target, on the same time, on the same beam. And let me summarize. It's the production of atom, it's production of Coulomb pairs, with Coulomb interaction in final state. But we have also non-Coulomb pairs. One pi plus, for example, produced as a straight, and pi minus produced from eta decay. The distance between two particles so large that Coulomb interaction in final state are negligible. And we have atomic pairs, pairs after atom breaking. We have Coulomb pairs, Coulomb effect, and non-Coulomb pairs. Also, there are accidental pairs when we have pi plus and pi minus from two different interactions. By definition, we have no final state interaction. Let me present our last data on the Coulomb pairs and Coulomb enhancement. Here on this axis, it's a longitudinal projection of full momentum in pi-pi system. And here is the yield of particles. We have small increasing of yield, but if momentum less than 2 MeV over C, then we have strong enhancement and it's a result of Coulomb interaction in final state. And studying Coulomb pairs, we know how much pairs we produce on this target in this time. Then about number of ionized atoms. Moving in the target, atoms can annihilate, and then our setup don't see these atoms, or can be ionized. After ionization, we have pi plus and pi minus with very small relative momentum in their center of mass because the binding energy is very weak. And in our notation, it's atomic pairs. On this figure, we have here on the axis lifetime of atom, its unknown parameter. And here we have probability of annihilation. Probability of ionization. And it is obvious that if lifetime is unity 10 minus 15, then atoms are annihilating and probability of ionization is 0.3. But if the lifetime is increasing, then probability annihilation is decreasing and probability ionization is increasing. After 20 papers about interaction of atoms with pi-pi atoms with material, we have precision of this curve on the level of 1%. For this reason, if we measured the number of ionized atoms or number of atomic pairs, and we know from the analysis of Coulomb pairs the full number of produced atoms, we can measure the probability of ionization and using this precise curve to obtain the lifetime. It's Dirac setup installed on the PS proton beam with momentum 24 GeV. It's two-arm vacuum spectrometer, and this property of this spectrometer, vacuum property, allows to have very good resolution on the relative momentum in pi-pi and pi-k system. For each component of relative momentum, we have the resolution 0.5 MeV over C. Its experimental results obtained and published. On this axis, we have QL, longitudinal project of momentum. Here we have Coulomb and non-Coulomb pairs, because atomic pairs, or pairs after atom ionization, are existing only in very small region. And we have Monte Carlo for Coulomb pairs, for non-Coulomb pairs, and only one unknown parameter is the ratio between these pairs. And we obtain this ratio in this region, and then it's the continuation of Coulomb and non-Coulomb pairs in this region. After subtraction, we have zero, and near in interval from 0 and 1.5, we have experimental distribution, And it is experiment of atomic pairs, or pairs after atoms ionization, and it is theoretical distribution which is coincide with experimental distribution. It is the same distribution of the same statistics on QT. On QT, it's transverse component of relative momentum. It's experimental data, it's Monte Carlo, and difference is points, and it is theoretical distribution. And we see that both distributions are describing theory very well. In this table, presented a result on pi and pi and scattering lengths, it's lifetime, it's our old result, it's our new result, they are coinciding. It's pi and pi and scattering lengths, A0 minus A2. It's coincide with theory and coincide with other method to measure this difference. It's a cusp effect observed in experiment NA48, and each allows, this effect allows also to extract from experimental data this difference. And precision of it's slightly better. It's for formally, if we go sub root square from this, it's very formal precision. It's 4.1%. It's 4.3% or 4.3%. It's slightly better. And it's obvious that precision for future, for measurement of this parameter, is 0.2, 0.3%, and it's obvious that this precision must be significantly improved. Now we have additional new data, because presented data used 21,000 of atomic pairs or ionized atoms, and we are expecting 3% with old and new data, but we must significantly improve about order the precision of multiple scattering measurement. But this is very successful measurement, and we hope that multiple scattering measurement will be made with precision better than 0.5%. Then about pi k scattering. The principal difference between pi pi and pi scattering is following. If we proved that theory describes pi-pi scattering very well, we cannot say nothing about pi-k scattering, because it's process pi-pi with U in D quarks, and it's confirmed this symmetry, but it's not confirmed the existence of this symmetry. And only confirmation that theory gives the precise, the right value for pi k scattering lengths will enlarge the group of symmetry from SU2 to SU3. The method to measure the lifetime in pi k atoms was described, is the same as for pi pi scattering. And here presented our data for pi k, for pi k system obtained in 2008, 2009, 2010 data. On this picture, we have distribution not on QL, module QL, but QL with positive and negative sign. And it's accidental pi k. And we see it as a homogeneous, the practically straight line. And for pi k prompt produced from one star, we have Coulomb enhancement. It's for k plus pi minus, and it's for k minus pi plus, the same picture. It's accidentals and it's enhancement. And analysis of this Coulomb pairs gave us that we have among this, we have in this experiment 600 pi k atoms. And now our main task to recognize atomic pairs from these atoms ionization in this particle. Then let me discuss the observation of long-lived Piper atoms. Because if we measure the energy difference between NS and NP state, then we can obtain the new combination of pi and pi scattering legs. But for this measurement, it is possible, in principle, to use a resonance method. And if this method will be justified, then the precision of this method can improve the precision of pi and pi scattering lengths on the order, or to achieve that level which is needed for future theory. What is the way to observe these atoms? And what is the way to create these atoms? It's description of our present experiment, which is going now. The proton beam produced in the beryllium target pi atoms with 1s, 2s, 3s, and other ns state. Moving in the target, this atom interacting with beryllium atoms can excite it into p, 3p, 4p, and other states. And 6% of these atoms, 6% of excited atoms, go out from this target in vacuum. But in this state, wave function of atom at zero distance is zero. For this reason, they cannot enter in the region of strong interaction. And the only way to annihilate is transition to P1s with radiation of real photon and annihilation. But this process is very slow. For this reason, this atom moving in this will go to platinum foil, 2 micrometer, and will be ionized and to give atomic pairs. But together with this atomic pairs, we have a lot of Coulomb and non-Coulomb pairs from this target and small number of atomic pairs from this target. To observe this, let me give the table of lengths, free lengths of these atoms. If atom, for example, have 4p state and its average Lorentz factor in our experiment, it will be 44 centimeter and other. Then, to suppress the large background from the target, Coulomb and non-Coulomb pairs, between beryllium target and platinum foil, there is weak magnet, and this weak magnet increased the Y component of relative momentum for all pairs produced on the target, and it is background pairs, and don't change the Y component of relative momentum for pairs produced on the platinum foil. Here are presented its QY, its component of momentum. It's the background from beryllium target, and it's a small number of atomic pairs produced after atom ionization in platinum foil. But after applying magnetic field, this background go on the right, and we have background in the region of our atomic pairs on 6 times less. Of course, for this experiment, 5 minutes, we need a permanent control of magnetic field, and this permanent control we are performing using electron-positron pairs. It's pairs produced after target, it's pairs produced on the target. And we have a distance because these pairs cross magnetic field. And using this peak, we have permanent control of magnetic field. And for a few months, its samarium magnet, the magnetic field changed on the value of 0.4%. Unfortunately, in our run 2011, we had a magnet from neodym and he decreased his strength more than 50%. But, of course, we can use this data, but efficiency is less. Then about a way to measure the magnetic field, the lamp shift. If in laboratory system we have strong magnetic field and its momentum of atom, then in the center of mass of atom, using Lorentz transformation, we have strong electric field. And this field will mix the wave function of 2p and 2s state, or 3p and 3s state and other things. And to decrease the lifetime, because lifetime of the system will be a combination. And without magnetic field, we have one number of ionized atoms, and with strong magnetic field, we have the other number of ionized atoms. And in this case, we can, comparing these two measurements, we can extract the lamp shift of the atom. Resonance method. Resonance method, it's creation in laboratory system, periodic field, and this periodic field will be mixed NS and P level only if frequency, it's between these two levels, will coincide with external frequency of this resonator. And for each resonator, we have only one Lorentz factor, which gives this mixing. And for this Lorentz factor, we will have mixing of long-lived and short-lived state, and the lifetime of this atoms with this Lorentz factor will be decreased. What does it mean? That if without resonator we have this distribution, and if we install, for example, four resonator, then, for example, for this resonator, we have strong decreasing of number of atoms, and knowing only the position of this Lorentz factor, we can calculate the splitting. And we are using for all this calculation theory with precision 10 minus 6. Of course, for this experiment, we need a large number of atoms, long-lived atoms. And here presented the yield of 8 to pi as a function of momentum of atom in laboratory system at present Dirac conditions, 24 GeV, 5.7 degree, and 4 degree and for momentum 450 GeV over C. It's for pi pi, it's the same distribution for pi k. On this table, we have coefficients. Yield for the same number of proton-nucleus interaction of pi-pi atoms is 17, and it's around 30. It's all, it's only conclusion. We measured now with 8% of lifetime measure. The lifetime of pi-pi atoms was measured with precision 9%, and we are planning, using existing statistics, to measure with precision of 6% and to extract pi and pi scattering lengths with precision of 3%. We measure the cross-section of pi-k atom production, analyzing, and we will try, of course, to observe atomic pairs. We believe, using preliminary analysis, that statistics obtained in 2011 and mainly in 2012 will allow us to observe the long-lived pi-pi atoms. And the same setup with our upgrade allows to measure the pi k atom lifetime with precision of better than 10% and to perform the first measurement of pi k scattering length. And we believe that it's possible to measure the length shift of pi pi atom, but with static magnetic field or with a resonant, it's a question mark, but with static, no doubt. Thank you. Oh, not thank you, but I have picture.
We thank you for a very nice presentation.
Thank you. Thank you.